week into the job and new Prime Minister Christopher Luxon is already walking back his words, forced to admit he got comments on smoke-free laws completely wrong. The PM and other ministers had claimed Northland would be left with just one cigarette-selling outlet if the new laws came in, despite being presented with evidence to the contrary.
Yeah, well, I haven't seen that list, but my understanding is that, and Northland is one of those examples, but there are other parts of the country.
But you just said one. Hang on a second.
You just said one. Seller of tobacco.
No, but you just said one, and that's
yeah, that's right. There'd be one store in Northland. That's my understanding. Yes.
That's what the Prime Minister said the other day as well. But the Director General of Health has published a list with 35 for Northland, so hardly starved.
Well, I haven't seen that list.
So it begs the question, where did the number come from and how did the new government get it so wrong? The Prime Minister joins us this morning. Good morning, Mr. Luxon. Who's doing your number crunching? 35's a long way from one.
Well, good morning, Anna. As I said yesterday, we got that wrong. And, but the meta point and the big point remains, which is limiting distribution to 600 outlets across the whole of the country. Does mean that there will be towns up and down New Zealand that have just one or two outlets in them. They'll become massive magnets for crime and retail crime, as we've already seen dairies being hit every single day. And also ultimately encourage a black market. So, we got the numbers wrong, but the meta point and the big point still remains.
OK, I want to talk about that bigger point in just a second, but I'm curious because it was mentioned by yourself, that number, 4 or 5 days ago, and then it was mentioned by Chris Bishop again. And all the while, there were journalists and other people saying to you, it's not one. There is not evidence that it's one. It is 35. So how come you persisted with the line that it was one?
Well, we got it wrong, and we've had that conversation with our team over the weekend to make sure that we are fact-checking everything that we are saying. So I'm confident that our new team will actually make sure that they do that in a much better way. But the point, as I said before, is that a major disagreement here is that actually limiting distribution just creates a magnet for crime and means ultimately we end up with a larger black market, which is not something that we want to see in New Zealand.
Yeah, where did that information about the black market come from? Where's the information that you've got about that black market?
Well, again, the issue very simply is when you remove distribution to points just to 600 across the country, you're going to be creating and putting a lot of sale of cigarettes underground and into the black market because the reality is there's going to be very few outlets in which you can purchase cigarettes from. And so what we really want to see is make sure that we don't make those places targets for crime. Dairies already, Anna, as you well know, every single day are being ram raided for cigarettes as it currently stands. It'll only get worse if there's fewer outlets and a single focus for crime.
OK, there was a lot of different points raised there. Ram raid numbers have come down in recent months. The statistics do show that those crimes are not being committed at the levels that they were perhaps earlier in the year, for example. But in terms of that black market...
No disrespect, Anna, we're celebrating from a very high base. And so
still coming down.
Not good enough. Yeah, that's great, and that's really good, and we want to see it coming down. That's why we have serious consequences for serious young offenders. That's why we'll continue to be tougher on law and order. But, the reality is we shouldn't be satisfied with where things sit today either.
Sure. Where did the evidence come from about a black market?
Well, it's just a natural reality. When you actually have less distribution outlets, it goes underground, it goes into a black market. Again, as just a reality of when you've got less supply, black markets take off across cigarette markets around the world in that case.
OK, so you don't have any evidence you can point to of someone who's done some number crunching or looked at another market that you can cite where black markets became a big issue when there were limits on the number of cigarettes sold?
Look, Anna, I get there's a difference of opinion about how to deal with this, but on this... let me tell you about it. The political parties opposed the legislation the government put in place. Let's be clear, we're not taking anything backwards because this legislation hasn't taken effect. It doesn't take effect fully for over 3 years as it was planned by the previous Labor government. We have a difference of opinion on that. We think the unintended consequences of that policy don't make sense. We are going to continue to drive smoking rates down. They have halved. 8% of New Zealanders now smoke on a daily basis. It's down from 16% just 10 years ago. We'll continue to drive smoking rates down in this country. We've already got smoking not visible to patrons. We've already made sure that we've increased excise tax just last week, and we'll continue our education efforts. We don't want people to take up smoking. We want to drive that down. We just disagree with the previous government's policy that that's the way to deliver that outcome.
OK. Is it fair to say then, in summary, if I've interpreted it right, that your biggest concern is the development of a black market if those numbers were limited?
just putting a huge focus on a number of stores, often a one or two stores in towns across New Zealand, that will become a major focus for crime and cause huge pain and suffering. You know, I had it just recently in my electorate, you know, a bashing that took place in a liquor store over the weekend. And I've visited many of these places that have been victims of these crimes. That'll only just get worse.
So if the law itself doesn't just focus on the number of outlets, though, there's a whole host of things, denicotisation, those sorts of things. Why didn't you consider perhaps amending the law or changing the law instead of repealing the entire thing?
Well, we'll continue to look at what we can do in the coming years to make sure that we lower smoking rates. There's a very strong commitment from our government to do exactly that. Smoking rates have come down tremendously over a number of decades. As I said, in the last decade, they've halved alone. We know that vapes play an important role for helping people get off smokes. We know that we also have a challenge on vapes to make sure that we have some serious consequences for selling to people underage, and we're going to continue to make sure that those penalties are tougher as well.
Okay, just to clarify though, why didn't you consider an amendment to the law?
Again, our focus is that we didn't like the bill beforehand, and as a result, we think the easiest thing is to repeal it, go back to what we have, and actually continue to drive smoking rates down over time.
Can I just ask, who wants cigarettes to be made available to kids?
Nobody wants them to be made available to kids, and that's why we've got to make sure, and that's why it's been great to see that smoking has gone, you know, people who are daily smoking, gone from 16%, 16.4, I think, from memory, down to 8%, and that's been good. We'll continue that progress.
Okay, but, I mean, it's not health officials. You've had huge pushback. The headlines from around the world, from the BBC, from NPR, from Time, health experts criticise new government's shock reversal. Are you concerned about the impact that headlines like this or news like this about New Zealand does a bit of damage to our reputation?
Not at all, because this legislation hasn't taken effect. It hasn't taken effect. And I know people like to talk about it as world-leading. That's lovely, but actually it hasn't taken effect. It's not been in action. And as I said, we've got a difference of opinion that actually has unintended consequences that we don't want to see.
What difference does it make that it hadn't taken effect?
Well, just it's not happening, is it? I mean, it's lovely. It's lovely that the government passed something just before the election that parties didn't support across the House. And as a result, we're just saying to you very clearly, we're repealing that and we'll continue to focus on driving smoking rates down. We've done that successfully under successive governments now for over 30 years. Our government remains committed to doing that. We just don't believe that this is the only means to deliver those ends.
Okay, Nicola Willis has said the tax gathered from cigarettes will be used to fund tax cuts. But she also said there was plenty of buffer in your tax cut plans. Can you do without the money?
Again, as I said to you last week, you know, we've gone through coalition negotiations. There's a mixture of policies, things like even moving from fees free for the first year to the third year, that all add up to make sure that we can fully fund our tax relief. We are going to deliver tax relief to low and middle income New Zealanders. They deserve it. We're in a cost of living crisis. They deserve to keep more of their own money to spend and save as they see fit. And so all three parties in our coalition government are aligned on that, and we have a fully funded tax plan.
Could you make your tax cut plan work without gathering the excise tax from those cigarette sales?
Well, we have a range of measures of revenue being raised and also savings being generated, which we're working our way through now. But I can tell you that is not the motivation for why we rejected the smoking legislation that the former Labor government recently passed.
OK, one last question. Winston Peters was causing a bit of distraction last week. You'll be hoping for smoother sailing this week?
Well, actually, I think we had a great week last week. We got sworn in on Monday. By Wednesday, day three, we actually announced a fully comprehensive 100-day action plan. I haven't seen that from any previous government. We're very focused on the things that matter. We're in a coalition government. I just say to everyone watching, look, it's got three different parties. It's got different personalities, different players. We will all say and express things differently, and that is okay. But what we are focused on are the things that are uniting us, is restoring and rebuilding the economy, restoring law and order, delivering better public services. That's what our 100-day plan's been about. That's what our coalition agreements have been about. That's why all three parties have signed up to the programs that we've developed with both ACT and New Zealand First, and they signing up with each other's. That's been important. That's unique and special. And as a result, that's giving us a massive work program. We spent most of last week going through briefings with officials here in Wellington and getting them to understand our priorities. And I think we've given maximum clarity. Now we need to get on and get things done. Let's be clear, this country needs a turnaround and it wants delivery, and that's what we're going to do.
What's the last day you'll be working right up until?
I'll be working right up until the 22nd of December. We've got a lot of legislation that we want to pass before Christmas. And so as a result, we're running Parliament into that last week before Christmas, which is unusual for Wellington here. And then we'll look to start up. I'll be back at work on the 15th.
All right. Prime Minister Chris Luxon, thanks for joining us this morning.
Appreciate it, Adam.